modeling and simulation. And so we'll have the presentation of Samuel Fenella from the Pontifical University of Lyon. And so just 20 minutes to stand in questions. Okay.
Good afternoon. So I will present this work about the model to quantify cathode crack growth by cycling the damage accumulation calculated by a circuit model. So, after discovering the crack growth, Elmer postulated that cathode damage could only be induced at the crack tip only if the crack is fully open during loads greater than the open load. He proposed that the crack tip driving force is, or it would be, the effective stress intensity factor inherent. And this idea, since then, has been used to develop many models, semi-hybrid models. Among them, these strip-in models that estimate open loads and also lives, of course, using a sweep table cathode crack growth equation properly fitting to experimental data. And the main objective of our work here is compare the capability of a strip-in algorithm and other alternative models based on accumulated damage to reproduce cathode crack growth curves measured at low and high stress region for two different materials. The strip-yield model numerically estimates the open load using the Dugdale-Barenblatt idea, but modified to leave plastic deformed material at the crack surface. And the algorithm that we implemented and we show here is based on the original Newman work from 1981, and we are using a cathode crack growth from Glasgow code. Plastic zone size and also surface displacement at this model are obtained by superposition of two linear elastic forms, a crack plate loaded by a remote uniform nominal tensile stress, and the uniform stress distributed over the segments, surface segments near the crack tip. Our algorithm discretized the plastic zone in a series of 20 rigidly perfectly plastic bare elements that yield at the full stress, or consider the strain hardening. And these elements are at the surface of the crack, broken or intact at the plastic zone. In both cases, keeping the residual deformations. This figure resumes well the procedure of the circuit body. When in contact, these elements at the crack surface, these elements that are broken, can carry compressive stress and can also yield in compression if the stress reaches the full stress. And the elements that are not in contact here not affect the crack surface displacement. This is a 1D model, and to consider the 3D stresses are of the crack tip due to the transversal plastic restrictions at plane strain conditions, we are using, like Newman, a constraint factor to increase the flow stress in the unbroken element during the loading. Here is the equation that used to calculate the displacement of the elements, this equation over all the circular procedures. And here is the static crack growth probe from NASBIC that we are using to calculate the static crack growth rates. And this equation has four constant fitted parameters that are fitted to experimental data. The critical damage model is very different from the structural model because we are using here the strain, the damage accumulated by the strain at the in front of the crack tip. So this model, we have some hypotheses that we assume here. The first one, the fatigue cracks grow by successively breaking small varying elements located ahead of the tips, the crack tips. These elements can be treated like a tiny epsilon specimens fixed along the crack path, and they accumulate fatigue damage induced by variable strain range, which increases as the crack tip approaches the crack. And the fracture of the volume element adjacent to the crack tip occurs because it accumulated the entire damage that the material can tolerate. And to apply the epsilon mechanics and properties here, it's necessary also to determine the plastic strain field at each load cycle. So, and the version of this model of 2002 calculates this plastic strain field using a HRR orange, using the HRR field shifted its origin into the crack to avoid the strain singularity that otherwise would occur at the crack tip. And to do that, the way adopted in that version is assume that this shift displacement is half of the crack tip radius, and the crack tip radius half of the CTOD, like Quid and Paris did in 1967. And with that, the cyclic plastic strain range ahead of the crack tip is calculated using this modification proposed by Schwab. And since the elastic strain rate, strain amplitude is neglected in this equation, its associated fatigue life is estimated from the plastic part of Kaufman-Hansel's equation here. And in a case of constant amplitude load, the cracks advance a distance equal to the volume element width in each cycle. So the damage accumulation sum can be approximated by an integral here. And it's possible with that determinate or estimate the fatigue crack growth rates. But to simulate the whole the three phases of the crack growth, we need to use with this calculation a fractal mechanical rule. And for that, crack growth rates were simulated under several load conditions, and these results from here one loop to calculate the sin constant of this equation. This is a modified McEvans work with only a constant. And this constant was calculated from the results from here. So, this is the cryptodimensional model. And after that, we proposed a combination between the strip yield algorithm and the critical damage model. So, the damage ahead of the crack tip based on plastic displacements from the strip yield model. We calculate that on a cycle-by-cycle basis. This model considers possible crack closure effects on the cyclic strain field ahead of the crack tip, but we not use the open stress.
No.
The plastic zone is divided into smart bar elements like the stupid model, but here with constant width and the number of elements vary up to 550, depending on the load conditions. The strip yield plastic displacement are transformed into plastic strain using this solution proposed by Rice. And like the critical damage model, we use the Coffin-Nansen's solution. And here also, SWP, default on top, both to calculate life. And fatigue crack growth rate by linear damage accumulation rule. And also, to consider the phases 1 and 3, we use results from this linear damage accumulation using this procedure here to calculate the C constant of the McEvans equation. So the difference of this model and the critical damage model is that we use here the strip yield to generate the plastic deformation field ahead defective instead of HRR field. So, after that, we proposed a modification of this combination called modified strip yield critical damage model. And this modification eliminates the need of assuming that the fatigue crack growth rate is described by this McEvans rule, adopting two new hypotheses. The first assumes that if a fatigue limit exists, there is also a limit strain range below the crack does not grow, below that the crack does not grow. And this limit is directly related to threshold stress intensity factor range. So, the second also assumes that the crack becomes unstable at a maximum plastic strain related to the critical stress intensity factor. And the modified plastic strain range is then calculated as shown here. And after estimating the plastic strain range, we calculate the damage of each element ahead of the crack tip by also Coffin-Nansen's and Smith-Watson-Topper rules. And the crack increment now directed from linear damage accumulation rule. The experimental results, here we have these three tables. The first one We have the materials profiles of the two materials that we have experimental data. So the aluminium alloy 775 and the carbon steel 1020. We have tested these two materials under two stress ratings, 0.5 and 0.5, in a range of stress intensity factor range. And the NASGRO parameters that we use for materials similar that we have tested are here, and also the constant C of the CPU critical danger model. So here we have the results for the aluminum alloy. This left figure here is 0.1 stress rate, and here 0.7. The points here is the experimental results. This black continuous line and also here is the strip yield model. The dashed line blue is the critical danger model, the version of 2003. The two dashed line here, green and orange, are the first version of our combined strip yield critical danger model, and the red one and yellow are the two results of the last batch of the strip yield critical danger model, the modified one. So we see here that for the 0.1 stress ratio, the almost all curves described in a visible way the experimental data. Maybe the coffee monster is red one is the best approximation here. The critical damage models, the version of 2003 and the first combination, deviated a little bit for high stress density factor range at the 0.7 stress rating. And here, the both strip yield model and also Kofmanso have a very good result. And for the steel, it's a little bit different. We have the critical danger model version 2003 as almost the best approximation of these points, mainly at the 0.7 stress rating. At 0.1 stress rating, this model generates results a little bit unconservative, and with similar performance we have here this repeat model with a little bit more conservative results. The combinations of strip yield critical damage model result in this case more conservative predictions, but at 0.7 stress ratio we have the Kofmanso critical damage model with a very reasonable result to the experimental data. And here the distributed model is not so good. So, to conclusion, these models that we present here describe reasonably well the measured data, and this indicates that even though apparently contradictory, such models are not incompatible. And the quite reasonable performance of the predictions also indicate that good fit of some property obtained data set is not enough to prove which is which one is the best. And because of that, we think that both should be considered at most as viable options to model that impact of behavior based on this experimental data. Limited to this. And the two hypotheses of the modified distributed critical behavior model proposed here to change this procedure have improved in general their results. So that's this.
Thank you.